I was returning to my home, surrounding by my family, my loved ones. We were grieving the loss, the unexpected death of my father. That was the day of his funeral. I had not eaten for 3 days. I was so swept up and so crushed by my dad's death. And I remember sitting on my parents' bed and the earth around me was moving. While that was true for my family, the earth around us was moving, was shaking with the death of my father. But I suddenly realized it was not just my bed. The bedroom, like the room, was moving back and forth. And somebody came in and grabbed me out and take me to safety. I saw my mom sitting outside on a chair, and her chair was shaking. I realized it was not just my whole world, but the whole world in Haiti was groaning. My country was groaning. My people was groaning. It was an earthquake, a devastating earthquake that killed around 300,000 people. And just a few weeks later, there was a devastating earthquake, another huge earthquake in Chile. Not too long after that, there was an earthquake in Japan. And then there was a typhoon in the Philippines that killed around 6,000 people, and almost 4 million had to be displaced. These tremors represent just a few of the many natural disasters that are happening around the world. But earthquakes and other natural disasters are not the only kind of tumult happening on Earth. Natural disaster and human disasters, economic and political crisis, terrorist attacks, wars, famines, and diseases. These are all the news headlines we see around the world. The earth is shaking. The earth is groaning. But beloved people of God, do you hear in such things creation groaning? Do you hear the groaning of which our text speaks? Creation groaning and traveling in pain as it waits for the manifestation of the children of God. The word of God in our text makes sure that we do not only notice what is happening in the creation, but we also understand it. But the text talked about suffering. Why is that suffering? It talks about suffering because the creation is not complete. But the suffering that Paul is talking about in this text may refer to the suffering of the early church. It was a time where Christianity was seen as a revolutionary group. The early Christians saw themselves as being transformative. They were seeking change. However, the whole idea of seeking change led to resistance of the Roman Empire, which ultimately broke out into persecution of the early church. Paul put this as a cosmic context because it is not just happening in the Roman Empire, the earth is groaning. When you think about the way Paul talks about creation groaning, it is like a woman in labor pain. It might make you wonder why women would go through the pain. I personally do not think women will be all for becoming pregnant if they did not feel like pregnancy provides possibility for something worth the pain and struggle. They have made the decision consciously to go through labor, which is struggle, pains, suffering, all of those things. But they are not doing it just for the sake of doing it. Because suffering is not redemptive in itself. They are doing it because they know that it is about to bring something new, a baby. When you apply this to Christians' faith, we become people of faith, knowing that faith is pretty much like going through labor pain. In a sense, it does come with pain. It does come with struggle. But we are not doing it just for the sake of struggling to say, hey, look at me, look how much I have suffered. We are doing this because we believe that there is some connection between the process of suffering and the future possibility of transformation. In verse 23, Paul speaks of how we wait for adoption. Paul is using adoption as a way of understanding this process of suffering. Adoption is a process. It's not something that happens all at once. For those of us who go through the process of becoming the children of God, we do not become children of God automatically or immediately, because we have to participate. And this becoming of the children of God, it requires some suffering, some struggling, which has to do with first taking on discipleship, which means subjecting ourselves to the teaching of Christ, which means having to learn our enemies, which means having to learn how to forgive those who have hurt us, which means treat one another right, which can bring suffering. What is happening in this text is that we have to participate to be able to be in God's family. God already did God's part in creation. Now it is time for us, as co-creator, to do our part, to be able to freely claim we are daughters and sons of God. When people become children of God, it changes the entire creation. The entire creation is transformed. The entire creation is redeemed. The making of a community of spirit, that's what chapter 8 of Romans is all about. It is when you form the spirit community and people are becoming children of God that leads to transformation, that leads to redemption. This is needed not only for people of God to be who they are called to be, but it is necessary for the creation to realize its full potential. Everything will be truly transformed when people become a part of God's family. Everything will be truly redeemed when we know how to open our hearts, open our doors to those who do not look like us, to those who have committed terrible crime in the past, to those who do not share our faith, to those who are homeless, like the refugees who are trying to cross the ocean every day, thousands and thousands of refugees trying to get to safety. Everything will be truly redeemed when we form a spirit of community. This text does not say anything about becoming a Christian community, but it talks about creating a spirit community as a people of God. What Paul is putting out here is that the making of a godly community, whether you call it a Christian community or a spirit community, brings about transformations, brings about redemption. This process of us becoming children of God requires an active waiting on our part. This text is suggesting that we are becoming the children of God. We are not that yet. God has done God's part. Now it is up to us to live into our adoption as daughters and sons of God, to join the family business in which God is involved, the salvation of all creation. During the process of waiting, we have some responsibilities. The discipleship process that we are going through requires change, and change requires loss and gain. Jesus came down to earth in the middle of suffering, in the middle of groaning. He went through suffering, through groaning, to bring us life. He lost his life, he gained it after, but to give us eternal life. Friends, whether God is giving or taking, this is how God creates. This is how God redeems. This is how God transforms. Are we really ready to be part of this process of becoming children of God? So when the earth is groaning, it is looking for this transformation, this redemption. As I told you earlier about the earthquake, as devastating as it was, it has brought about new realities. Those new realities bring with them new possibilities. Haiti before was a hidden place, the poorest in the Western Hemisphere, forgotten and left behind. Regardless the real tragedy and loss that the earthquake caused, it brought the already devastating realities of Haitians' life to the forefront of the world's attention. It was a wake-up call for Haitians. The earth is groaning, and when we look at how tumultuous the weather has become, we got to do something. Our environment is telling us something. The earth is groaning. We are groaning, and I have a feeling, my friends, something has been born in our midst. The contractions, the pushings are happening. The earth is groaning, so whether you want it or not, it will happen. What God is doing is that he's doing something cosmic. And remember, what is happening with us is not something that is isolated. but it is all connected with the entire world. We are all connected. We impact one another, and we are impacted by one another. So what happens if we really make a commitment to really encourage persons to consider becoming a part of the God's family? According to this text, the family of God has the ability to change not just the local setting, but the world. With all that is going on in the world, you can feel that when talking to one another, a lot of us feel like the world needs to change. Something needs to be done. Recently, the city of Paris was frozen in fear by a coordinated act of terrorism. There was much debate whether the city of Paris was capable of hosting a 200 nations conference on climate change so soon after the attack. The city groaned, but out of that groaning came the confident birth of 200 nations agreeing on a plan of hope and salvation for the world. According to Paul, waiting is more than sitting back, but waiting eagerly, being engaged in participation while we are waiting. That is what hope means. Because hope is not just an expectation, but hope is confidence. For 3 years before I left my country, Haiti, my job was to serve as host and interpreter for church groups from the United States. I was the eyes, the ears, not just interpreting words from Creole to English, but also helping them truly to see reality of my country. The American came to help, but in the eyes, they tended to see the hopelessness of my country. It was my job to help this American understand that Haitians are not hopeless people. In some ways, we are fighters. We tend to believe that tomorrow is going to be better, but we have to work. We have an expression in Creole, même si on a misé, si on goûte, demain, gain pour le people. In the midst of suffering, if you participate, if you do your part, tomorrow is going to be better because God has done God's part. Haiti is the first black nation in the world to declare its independence 212 years ago. We are the Republic of Haiti. And even though we won our independence, we are still groaning, still struggling, and still waiting for our redemption. But God has done God's part, and we must do our part as Haitians to create a more godly and just society. The earth groans, Haiti groans, Paris groans, the Middle East groans. We all groan under the weight of not fully claiming our adoption as God's children. We do our part just as God has done God's part. We wait in active hope, in active and confident participation. The earth groans, and we await our adoption as sons and daughters of God. Amen.